Welcome friends. In the previous video, we have started the chapter of finite element analysis. In the previous videos, we have discussed the first part of the chapter. In that, we have seen the stepwise procedure of finite element method. After that, we have discussed the Pascal's triangle, then elements used in the finite element method. So, in this video, we'll discuss shape function or interpolation function. Many times in the examination, question is asked, write a short note on shape function and enlist methods available for deriving shape function. Or the question may be asked, write a short note on shape function. We know that in the process of finite element method, the third step is of selecting the interpolating function, that is shape function. Now, what is this shape function or how it is selected, which are the methods for selecting this interpolation function? So let's see this in this video. In finite element method in FEM analysis, the displacement model, we assume the variation of displacement within the element, since the true variation of displacements are not known. But in higher engineering mathematics, analytical solution of same problem is either not known or difficult to find. In such cases, we replace that function by another function which is easy to solve mathematically. That function is called as shape function or interpolating function. In short, I'll summarize this as, if there is a function which cannot be solved using the mathematical analytical solution, or it is very difficult to solve with the regular mathematical expressions, then this function is replaced by another function which is called as shape function or interpolating function. So this shape function or interpolating function has magnitude of unity or one at each node. Now let's see what are the methods for deriving the shape function. There are four methods of deriving the shape function. First method is shape function using polynomial. Second is shape function using natural coordinate system. And third one is shape function using Lagrangian interpolation method. And the fourth and last one is shape function of serendipity family elements. So these are the methods for the for deriving the shape function. So if the question is asked, write a short note on shape function and enlist the methods, you can write the answer till this point. So first of all, we have to explain the interactive part of the shape function, that is why this shape function is implemented and what is this. Okay, and in the next part, we have listed out the types or the methods of deriving the shape function. Okay, now let's see what are the requirements of shape function. First, these are the three mandatory requirements for the shape functions. So the shape function should be continuous and compatible. So we know the meaning of continuous, and I will explain what is compatible function. The function which will not change suddenly, that is called as compatible function. So or it will not have irregular changes. So that type of function may be compatible. Now second criteria or requirement for shape function is, it should have constant, or it should represent constant strain condition. The function should represent constant strain condition. That is the second requirement of shape function. And the third one is it should represent rigid body condition also. Means this function should be involved with some constant which will represent constant strain condition and rigid body condition. So these are the three requirements of shape function. We have already discussed that there are four methods for deriving the shape function. So we'll see how to derive the shape function of one dimension, that is two noded bar element, using polynomial. So shape function using polynomial. Now we have taken two noded bar element here. I have taken reference point or reference axis here, so that's why it will be zero here. And at first node we have taken this x1 displacement, and at the second node x2 displacement. So for two noded bar element, as we have discussed this in the previous video of Pascal's triangle, that for bar element we can write or we can select polynomial function as alpha 1 plus alpha 2 into x. Okay, in this is constant and this is the variable which is having multiplying constant. So in the generalized form we can write this x equation as in the curly bracket u equal to matrix of 1 x 1 and x in the same row, and this alpha 1 and alpha 2 in the curly bracket. So in the generalized form this is written as this, and it is given equation number 1. Now we'll go towards the second step of this method, that is displacement function in terms of nodal displacement. So we'll write displacement function in terms of nodal displacement. Okay, so we have written u1 and u2 here, and we have taken 1 and x1 for first point. That is, if suppose this is x1 is the first point, for this point displacement, total displacement from this point is if suppose this bar is at this position, so whatever this distance may be, now we have taken this as alpha 1. So here we have taken alpha 1 into 1. So u1 will be equal to alpha 1 for this. And if this x1 displaced in some new position in this direction, so the displacement will be taken as x1 into alpha 2. So this constant is for the further displacement. If this point is not displaced anywhere, or if it is there, then this alpha 2 will be 0 at the start. So that's why u1 will be equal to alpha 1. So likewise we have taken first function u1 equal to 1 into 1 matrix of 1 x1 1 x2 for u2, and it is in the multiplication we have taken alpha 1 and alpha 2. So in the generalized form we can write this as u1, the curly bracket of u1 and u2 is taken as x suffix e into matrix of a into this curly bracket. In the curly bracket we have taken the alpha as a representative constant generalized term. Okay, now if you find value of alpha from this equation, so we have to take this on the left hand side. So that's why we have taken this alpha here, and we have written this A, this matrix A will become A inverse when we take it on this side. So A inverse into curly bracket of x into x suffix e. We have named this equation as equation number 2. Now we'll put equation 2 in equation 1. So this is value of alpha, it should be substituted here. So what will be the new equation? So we have written that equation here, matrix of P, that is that was already there. So this is value of alpha which is written here, Now, for some time, we'll assume this multiplication of these two matrix equal to n. So, into this x suffix e is already is as it is. So now we'll solve this multiplication. We know that matrix P, what we have assumed to P, so it was 1 in 1 matrix 1 x, that is P. So we have taken that value of P here. A is what? X2 minus x1. So let's see what is A. A is this matrix. So A inverse will be, A inverse is what? A inverse is adjoint of A divided by determinant of A. So adjoint is already taken here, and this is determinant. So how it came? So let's say let's check. Determinant of this matrix is x2 minus x1. Okay, so what is x2 minus x1? Let's see here. From this point, 0 point, if we take x2 minus this length, x2 is this length, minus x1 will be this. If we deduct this length, this smaller length from this whole length, then we'll get L, because this length minus this length will be total, this length is remaining, so that's why L. So we have taken directly determinant equal to L. So that's why we have taken here, this is P, 1 by determinant of A into adjoint of A. So that is why we have taken this. Okay, and if you multiply these two matrices, then keeping this constant outside of the multiplication, so we'll get in the first row x2 minus x1, in the second row x minus x1. This 1 by L is outside of the bracket. So now we have written n1 n2 equal to, because we have assumed this as matrix n, so that's why we have taken n1 and n2. If you calculate value of n1 from this equation, so you will get n1 equal to x2 minus x1 divided by L, and n2 equal to x minus x1 by L. And if you compare this equation, or if you put this value of this equation is equation number 3. So if you put the value of this, or you can write from equation number 3, that is this equation, and if you put these values, you will get u is equal to n1 u1 n2 u2, because this x is nothing but it is bracket of u1 and u2. So that's why we have taken this is n1 u1, sorry, n1 n2, and this is bracket of u1 u2. So that's why it will be n1 u1 n2 u2. So this is equation of displacement. So it will be the shape function for two noded bar element. So this is how we'll derive bar element for by using function of polynomial. So if you have not understood anything, you can ask me. I'll quickly revise what we have done in this. In the two noded bar element, we have taken the polynomial function first, that is u is equal to alpha 1 into alpha 2x. We have written the generalized form here. Okay, after that, in the second step, we have find out displacement function in terms of nodal displacement. That is, we have taken u1 u2 equal to 1x matrix of 1x1 1x2 alpha 1 alpha 2. Again we have generalized it, and we have found out the value of alpha 1 and alpha 2, means that is bracket of alpha in this. After that, we have substituted this value into first equation of polynomial which we have assumed, and after the substituting this value, we have assumed P into multiplication of P into A inverse equal to n. So again we have simplified this multiplication and we have found out values of n1 and n2, and we have written the final equation of shape function. So it is very simple if you remember it by step by step. So if you try to find out by using polynomial, it is very easy. Okay. So thank you.